Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlop, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today I'm going to share with you an explanation for why not to use unit tests for AOT training runs on JDK 24, a garbage collection primer and comparison, two tips on how to analyze your Maven build, the announcement that final will eventually mean really final and how to simulate that today, a detailed look at how to build an advanced retrieval augmenter for querying AI models, and last but not least, the roadmap for value types and null restriction, but no timeline, so don't get too excited. All of this and so much more was discussed at JavaOne 2025 a few weeks ago, where we had lots of talks from both OpenJDK insiders as well as from community experts. A few recordings are already online, the others will be published over the coming weeks. Subscribe or track this playlist if you don't want to miss them. Ready? Then let's dive right in. During one of our live streams, I talked to Dan Heidinger, who works on Project Leiden, about ahead of time class loading and linking JDK 24, and especially about training runs, when he told me this.
The big thing you want to avoid with a training run is loading classes that you don't need in your production run. So if your benchmark loads a whole bunch of classes that will never be used in production, that may not be the best training run.
Mm-hmm. That also excludes unit tests by definition, right? Because like the entire unit testing frameworks and assertion libraries and all of that is in there.
It does. There are probably ways you can configure things to make that more useful.
Yeah.
Because what we've done so far and what we've shipped in JDK 24 optimizes the three built-in class loaders. Mm-hmm. So the system loader, the application loader, and the extension loader.
So unit tests are not only questionable training runs because they execute the application code very differently from an application run. With the default configuration, they also pollute the cache with lots of unnecessary classes. I think the configuration Dan has in mind to fix this would load your application code into the application class loader, but the testing framework, assertion library, etc. into a custom class loader that the OT cache would ignore. There were a bunch of really good talks about garbage collection. The segment I picked here is pretty early in Stefan Johansson's talk. He gives a high-level overview of OGC performance aspects and the strengths of each OpenJDK GC.
In many cases, we talk about three different aspects here. The first being throughput. Do you care mostly about throughput? And what we mean by that is the number of transactions that you can complete in a set amount of time. Then we also have latency, which is more about a single transaction. Is that affected by, say, for example, a GCPOS, the latency can be bad and the transaction can take a long time. And then we have footprint, the overhead caused by the GC algorithm. It's very hard to optimize for all of these at once. So usually we have to do a lot of trade-offs. If we try to illustrate a trade-off, it can look something like this. We have a set of application threads. At some point, we realize we need to do garbage collection work. We do this in a GCPOS using multiple threads, trying to make sure that the GCPOS is as short as possible before letting the application threads run again. This is pretty good from a throughput perspective because when the application threads run, no GC work is going on, so they don't have to compete for CPU resources. On the other hand, from a latency point of view, it's not optimal because we have the GCPOSs and they take a significant amount of time. So if we care more about latency, we can have something that looks a bit more like this. So again, we have the application threads, but when we realize we need to do garbage collection work, instead we do a very short GCPOS, and instead do the heavy GC work concurrently with the Java application threads running. So from a throughput perspective, this might be a little bit worse because the GC threads and the application threads compete for the same resources. On the other hand, latency-wise, it's much better because the GC pauses are much, much shorter. In OpenJDK today, we have five different garbage collectors. We have Serial, which has a main focus on low memory overhead. We have Parallel, which is a throughput collector aiming to provide as good throughput as possible. We have G1, or the garbage first collector, which has a balanced performance profile. And then we have CGC and Shenandoah, which both aim at providing good low latency alternatives for Java.
Stefan then dives deeper into performance improvements of these GCs across Java versions and recounts the positive outcomes Netflix, Mercado Libre, LinkedIn, and OCI had when upgrading their runtimes. Another great talk on this space that I can recommend is from Eric Osterlund on ZGC. Have you ever been confused by your Maven build? Maybe why it's taking so long? If not, I can only assume you've never used Maven. And I'm not hating on it. It's just that real-life projects tend to get messy, and their builds are surely no exception. Watch Richard Fichtner use an extension and a plugin to gain some insights.
We need something special, and this time it's not a Maven plugin, we need an extension. So what's the difference between a plugin and an extension? An extension is better, bigger, and can see the class loader for the plugins, because we need that to profile the plugins. Let me show you how this looks. Looks something like this. You will create a file called extensions.xml. Looks like this. So very similar to a plugin. And you put it in the .maven folder of your project. And it's in Git, so it's in version control. So you don't have to touch the build server, the CI, nothing. So this is now there, OK? But be cautious, as they are, they have a lot of rights and access. Don't trust everything. So I know this is a good plugin because this is from Karl-Heinz Merbase. And let's do Maven Verify first, of course. OK, we get some things. I get some numbers for my pizza backend. And it tells me, OK, there's a lot of things going on, how much each phase took. And to understand that a little bit better, we can use a build plan plugin to see what is happening. And this was very good for me to see this when I saw it the first time, to better understand what is happening. And this plugin has more goals with other outputs. And here you can see that in the validate phase, we have two plugins registered that will run when I do validate. When I do compile, basically everything before that runs. And you can see actually what's going on. For in this example, of course, this is easy. This is not the real world. Run this on your project that you're working on day to day, and you will see crazy things if the project is older than maybe 10 days, OK?
If you're wondering about the short burst of music during his build, or why to prefer Maven Verify over Maven Clean Install, don't miss this talk. I also recorded two long conversations that will end up as episodes of the Inside Java podcast, which you can find pretty much everywhere, but just to make sure, there's a link in the description. One was with Mark Reinhold, who dropped big news and then preempted their announcement here by publishing a JetDraft just a few days after Java 1. Not cool, Mark.
There's a new API called Stable Values, which does a few things, but mainly the idea is to have finality for something that is initialized late. But that then is really, really final, just like the record components are really, really final. And I'm going to go out and guess that probably Valhalla's value types fields are also really, really final.
They are so final, you wouldn't believe how final those fields are.
Is there any way to backport that? Like, could you give me a flag where I say, I want final to mean final, and, you know, screw the code in my code base or my dependencies that doesn't respect that? Because, you know, in that case, I guess that accessible will throw an exception, so I would probably find out the runtime.
There is a JVM flag. Mm-hmm. I forget what its name is. Starts with the letters XX.
Okay. we'll put it on screen maybe here in post-production. But so are there ideas to make TrustFinal an option, maybe even the default?
Oh, no. We plan to make it the default over time.
Oh, right. Cool.
And that there is a JEP already for prepare to make final fields.
Oh, really? There's a JEP draft, I hope, at least. Otherwise, I would feel kind of ashamed that I don't know that.
Okay,
so just delete
this in post-production. I'll look it up.
As you can imagine, a big chunk of talks related to artificial intelligence in some way, shape, or form. From OpenJDK's code reflection and head to various frameworks, from the announcement of Oracle Code Assist to coding guidelines and security concerns, just so much AI. I picked a short section from Liz Reis and Mohammed Ait Abdirahman's presentation of a research agent where they explain how they built its advanced retrieval augmentation pipeline, which is essential to get the best possible replies from the AI model you'll eventually query.
To mitigate all these little problems, we came with this retrieval augmenter in LangChain4j. So instead of just a content retriever, we now have the augmenter. It's all interfaces, so if you want to build your own version of it, you can. I've put underneath our default implementations that you can easily use. So let's start in the middle there with content retrievers. Instead of having one content retriever that searches in your documents, you can have multiple ones, and they can also do more things. So we have an embedding store that's going to search in your documents, but you also have GraphRag, SQL, and a web search engine coming out of the box. You can write your own one for any API calls, for example, if you want a weather service, for example. Now, how do we know which content retrievers to pick? There's a query router in front of that, typically also powered by an LLM, that's going to say, oh, given this query and given all these content retrievers I have, I'm going to send it there or to multiple at the same time. And it's going to also rewrite your query, because a web search query, of course, is very different from a SQL query. And LLMs can write proper queries. Then in front, we have this query transformer that I talked about before. The compressing query transformer will take your history into account to make a sensible question and not just yes, please. Expanding query transformer will make it into even more questions, so it's sure to find the answer. At the other side, once the content pieces are retrieved, we can just put them together in the default content aggregator. So it's going to put one after the other. But very often, there are pieces in there that are irrelevant to the question, after all. And typically, they will confuse your model, and your model will answer something that has nothing to do with your original question. You will wonder why. Well, it's because RAG found pieces that were, like, for example, if it had started talking about the book it found there, it could have happened. So we're going to, we also added a re-ranking content aggregator. It calls a small scoring model that has one function: how relevant is this piece of content to the question? And it will kick out everything that's not relevant enough. Content injector will just add the original question and all the pieces of information that are important too. And that's what is sent off to the model.
Even though he'd never say it, Brian is giving off strong Valhalla soon vibes. In his talk about Java's language evolution, he even went so far to show a roadmap, meaning a list of JDK enhancement proposals that cover Valhalla's first feature arc, in the order in which he expects them to land.
So there's a bunch of JEPs on the roadmap. Some of them have numbers, some of them don't yet have numbers. JEP 401 is the first piece. It's basically value classes, and that's it. And that is well underway. The spec has been stable for over a year. We're just polishing the implementation. There's a second early access coming out fairly soon. And then, looking a little farther down the road, there's null restricted types as a concept on their own. There's null restricted types in the context of value types, which adds in some interactions and optimizations. And then there's sort of a cleanup JEP to sort of minimize the gap between the legacy primitives and the null restricted variant of their box types. And I'm sure these are not going to be the only four.
Cool. Can't wait. But now I'm heading off to a holiday, which means that in 2 weeks you'll have to make do with Billy, say hi to him from me, and maybe make a joke about that monstrosity he calls a haircut. And I'll see you again in May. So long!